long lenses have the opposite qualities to a short lens. Now then, exactly the same thing. We're on the tripod because the camera mustn't move. This time, we're going to go the other end of the spectrum. I want you to set your longest focal length. That's your most powerful zoom. In this case, 210 millimeters. Everything else stays pretty much the same. All I want you to do is to go back to your widest aperture, okay? Your lowest F number. That's the shallowest depth of field. Again, on manual focus, you need to focus in close. Now, because of the characteristics of a long lens, which has a very narrow field of view, you probably won't be able to do what we did with the wide one, as in choose the closest focus distance and move in. So what I want you to do is to absolutely duplicate the size of the tape in the frame, okay? This takes a bit of fiddling and a bit of thinking. Look at the shot you took with the wide lens and just think, how much space is my piece of red tape occupying in the picture? And then set up as close as you can the same shot. So to do that, you've got to be further away from the tape because of the magnification of the long lens. So I'm coming back here somewhere and again looking straight down the side of the shed, zoom in onto the tape, fiddle with the focus. Now we're just going to have to tweak the focus. Yeah, that's about the right place. It's getting a bit closer. Only a bit, because I want the tape the same size as in the earlier pictures with a wide lens. There we go. Just make sure that's bang sharp on the tape. There we go. Lock your tripod so that nothing's moving. I'm going a bit closer to the wall because I still want to be able to see the trees in the background. It's a tricky shot to set up, this one. Right, there we go. We're looking straight down the wall. We've got the tape nice and sharp, and straight away, you can see how tiny that block of focus is on the wall. It's minute. It's only going about that far either side of the piece of tape. It's like that. It's ridiculously small. With a wide lens, the same shot, it was going up here a few feet, wasn't it? Now, we do the same thing in this exercise as before. Widest aperture. In my case, it's f5.6. We have a look through and we take the picture. As you can see, tiny, tiny depth of field. Next, whoops, I didn't mean to take an extra shot then. Go to your middle aperture again, f11, exactly the same as before. All we've done is alter this focal length and take the same picture. It's expanded a bit, not a lot, but a bit. Again, all the way now to the smallest aperture. Long lenses often have much smaller apertures. This one goes down to f45. That's a tiny, tiny little pinhole. And we take the shot. Depth of field at f45 has now stretched off down the shed quite a long way, hasn't it? We're almost to the end of the shed. But the trees in the picture, you can see there's trees there, but they're fuzzy and blurred. With a long lens, you can't get the foreground and the background sharp. It's not doable. Long lens characteristics mean they have a very small block of focus, but you can shift that block of focus backwards and forwards along the subject. Let's have a look, see what I mean. Now, we're focused on the piece of tape. As you rotate your focus ring manually, you can actually watch, do it slowly, you can watch that piece of focus move along the shed, off to the trees, and then turn it the other way, and all the way back to the piece of tape. That's what I mean by having a chunk of focus which you can roll backwards and forwards in and out of your picture to get the depth, to find the point where you want to focus. One quick question you may be asking. Why is it when I set a very small aperture, I can't see that in the viewfinder? It's because on a digital SLR camera, the lens doesn't actually stop down to that little tiny aperture until the very precise moment you press the shutter. If it did, the viewfinder would be very dark. You wouldn't be able to see what you're doing. The aperture is the main control as to where, as to how much you can get with your given lens. But there's one last piece, and that is the distance between your camera and your subject. Let's just go back to that original shot at the beginning of the film again. It's not quite the same shot as it was at the beginning because the sun's moved round now. The trees behind me are soft, just as they were at the beginning of the film. This time we're going to make the trees come sharp, but we're not going to change the focal length of the lens and we're not going to change the aperture. The only thing that will change now is the distance between the camera and myself. So as I start to move backwards away from the camera and that distance is getting bigger, Jane follows me with the focus, the trees behind me are slowly getting sharper because the focus ball, if you like, is rolling towards them. So now I'm fairly sharp, and so are the trees. Yes, I know I've got smaller in the viewfinder, but your trees are sharp and I'm sharp. If I come towards you, we're going to decrease the distance between me, the subject, and the camera. And as I get closer, so the trees start to go fuzzy. I'm coming beyond where I was and coming in even closer. Now I'm up here, we've got a very soft background, and I'm the subject of the picture. So the things to get your head around with depth of field are these three concepts. The aperture is the main control of depth of field or depth of focus on the camera. As you use a big aperture, you have a shallow depth of field. As you use a small aperture, you have an enormous depth of field. Short wide lenses have massive depth of field. Inherently, you'll have real trouble trying to get a blurry background with a wide angle lens. And finally, the distance between you and your subject has an impact on the depth of field and how blurry the background is. You want to do close-ups, macros, you've got a minute depth of field. Great for making you concentrate on that bug or insect.